last night The Debt premiered at Toronto.
Yep.
Was this is your second time going through this?
Yes.
Fun.
Yes.
Was
yes.
it fun? Is it fun for you, or is
it fun? It's a very, very receptive festival. It's a very generous festival. It feels to me the audiences seem to have with them a sense of I don't know, privilege or something, that they get exposed to all these movies that are coming out at the end of the year, and it's increasingly obviously become a kind of a focus for all the fall movies. Mm-hmm. It's where they get unveiled. And, you know, my sense is a lot of people come here and, you know, come get off work for 10 days mm-hmm. and just literally blitz the movies. So they're very, very motivated. They're very receptive. Well, that was my experience anyway, certainly. Yeah. Last time I was here, and very much last night, yeah.
So I guess you're happy that you are part of the fall movie season and yes. the Blitz. Were you? Have you been wondering what the fate of this film would be with all the changes at Miramax? And
I think, yeah, there was a little bit of momentary anxiety when Miramax was sort of shuttered just as we locked the movie. But in fairness, we were immediately assured by the new management, as it were, at Disney, that they were absolutely supportive of the film and intended to take care of it. It was a little unclear for a while whether, in the putative, you know, garage sale that was going on of Miramax and its back catalogue, whether we would be included in that sale. But as it happened, we're not, so we're being released by Disney.
It's really an odd experience last night of going from one party where Harvey Weinstein was there, and I explained to somebody that he used to run Miramax, and then we went to your party, after party, for The Debt, and saw Dan Batzik, and was like, he used to run Miramax, too.
That's right. And later, if you'd stayed at the party, Harvey would have turned up at that one,
there
too.
There you go. To reclaim the throne.
I know. No. It's very odd. Odd for me, too, because I was with the Harvey Weinstein yes. Miramax for such a long time, and then the first movie I made outside the deal I had with him was for Miramax, you know, the new Miramax.
Your freedom. So was it an escape from Harvey, or
it was
did it feel like
time,
that after a while?
It was time for us to part company, I think, and yeah, and do things separately for a while.
So how did this particular piece come to you?
It came to me via Matthew Vaughan, and it came to Matthew Vaughan via Ari Emanuel at Endeavor, who had some connection with the people who made the original Israeli movie that it's based on, Hachov. And I think Ari thought it might be interesting to Matthew possibly to adapt or do a remake of. And Matthew and Jane Goldman, his writing partner, did an adaptation of the script, really with Matthew, obviously, was had it in mind to direct it.
Right.
But it coincided with another film of his, theirs, Kick-Ass.
Yes.
Very
similar kind of movie.
And I think they decided that, or Matthew decided he couldn't do both projects, and so he sent their script to me. Mm-hmm. They were involved, obviously, in Kick-Ass and therefore not able to work on the material with me. Because they were so preoccupied with their film. So I then developed the script with Peter Strawn, who's the other credited writer, who I knew and is a good friend of mine, and it evolved from there.
So what were the elements that got your juices flowing?
That what?
They got you excited?
Well, not many projects that come along that which mix genres in this way. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, a thriller is always an enticing prospect for a director because it's very exacting kind of form. You know, you've really got to be pretty sure about where you're putting your feet, and it's a challenge, but it's also very liberating because fear is the best possible emotion to work with in the movies. But actually, more seriously, it seemed to me a story that contained many other layers. You know, it had real emotional complexity and psychological complexity and moral depth, you know, and it was about something real and serious that was embedded in a very, very gripping narrative. It's a very, very strong story, which has sort of architectural configuration where it's always pulling against itself, and what the characters are doing governs the narrative. A great twist, you know, and some very good... It's just never quite where you think it is. I mean, that's true of espionage literature you know, anyway. But it
but emotionally, you don't always know where it's going to be.
You don't know where you are emotionally or where it is. No. So, and I thought that it had the possibility to expand and get more complex in all of those areas, which is sort of what happened, I think.
You guys played with?
Yes.
So that you have the one of the big elements of the film is that you have the young and the older versions of each of these characters.
Yes.
So was that complicated to deal with? Was that one of the easier things to kind of mess around with?
I think it, you know, it was complicated initially from a casting standpoint, because obviously if you don't get that right or in a way that the audience finds easy to accept, that could be a problem. But looked at another way, you know, if you'd imagined, and I think there were some views expressed early on by people who might have been buyers of the project, this is really before my time, that the time gap should be shrunk so that the characters could be played by the same actors. I felt that was always wrong, and certainly Matthew and Jane did, because it's not going to be about makeup or about aging. You know, it's actually about the relationship between past and present in terms of, you know, the choices you make and who that. What sort of moral being you become as a result of those choices.
Right.
And I think an audience accepts very willingly the convention that actually, you know, the same person is two different actors. And I think it's precisely because of the act of imagination that's involved, or the suspension of disbelief that's involved in making that jump. It's a way of engaging the audience more deeply rather than getting them involved in the distraction about, you know, how they made that person look 20 years older.
Well,
also, it's about characters at different ends of their lives, and I think you need that gap.
Well, I think that was actually really key to the whole story, is that there is that enough space that, you know, their lives really have gone on, and that you really do feel like they're vested in different ways and in this story having been told.
Yeah, exactly. And 30 years is a long time. Yeah. And one doesn't want to give the game away about what actually happens in the story, but that's a long time for lives to alter and evolve, and you know, for real dramatic change to have occurred, which is what happens in the story.
And for people the age of Tom Wilkinson and Helen Mirren to be making those choices,
yes,
actively or otherwise, is significantly different than having a, you know, 50-year-old.
Yeah, well, exactly, and it wouldn't mean the same thing if it were a 10-year-old problem.
Right.
A 30-year-old problem is a very, very different matter, particularly because of the introduction of a further generation, which is really the kind of emotional core of the story, is the Helen Mirren character's relationship with her own daughter and what that means in terms of the subject matter of the story.
The only issue that I had at all was that Sam seemed to have grown 6 inches as he got older. Usually you shrink.
Trying to shrink here.
That was the only one that I was, though it was, I was actually very, I thought Martin Chokosh did an amazing job.
He's fantastic.
Doing Wilkinson.
Yeah.
He's just, and he was himself. I mean, he's got that energy he has.
Yeah.
But you saw Wilkinson in him.
Yeah, yeah.
At times, which is really beautiful.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. No, I just try to be open-handed about what, you know, what. There's a moment where you, I guess, you're presented with the juxtaposition of Kieran Hines and Sam Worthington at a time when you probably can't completely compute what's going on. But I think, I just believe that if you enter that contract with an audience, they just buy into it and move on. You know, it's successfully. It has to be said that with Jessica Chastain, who plays the younger version of Helen, that I was much more conscious of wanting to get that right and plausible from a physical standpoint, because she's the center of the story.
Right.
And I very much wanted to cast an actor who didn't have, you know, an existing relationship with an audience, particularly, because then it's about how does actor A turn into actor B.
Right.
And, you know, there's a very good physical affinity between those two actors, and Jessica channeled Helen very well and very brilliantly, I think.
For one of the six, she's really the only non-celebrity actor, I guess.
She is.
In the group.
She is. I mean, she will be for sure, because she's got a whole body of work that's about to come out now. Mm-hmm. But But no, I felt incredibly lucky to find her.
We're also amazed to see so many non-Jews playing Jews. I don't know if it's good or bad for your career to play a Jew, but it was like a bunch of Israelis from Australia and Ireland. And
we do have Romy Abalafia.
That's true. You at least have that. Okay, so was casting, I mean, was financing the movie and the casting connected in ways?
I think it always is.
Because you have degrees of celebrity of different age groups.
No. To be honest with you, I think from the point of view of the studio, mm-hmm. the presence of Helen in the film
kind of did the
made it essentially a viable project. Mm-hmm. Certainly Sam Worthington, you know, who obviously has a lot of commercial ballast.
Right.
Now, that was not a consideration at all. I cast him before knowing, I subsequently discovered, of course, that he made Avatar and Terminator Salvation, but none of those movies had come out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I suppose that's the commerciality of that or otherwise is a bonus. Certainly was not on the agenda.
So you shot this before those came out, but after he had shot them?
Yes. I actually flew to Albuquerque to pitch the movie to him because I'd seen another movie he'd done, his kind of breakout movie in Australia, called Somersault, which just immediately I couldn't think of a better casting. And I didn't know who he was, really, or what he was doing. I wasn't aware of his name. And then subsequently realized that I had to go to Albuquerque to meet him, and that was because he was shooting the end of Terminator Salvation. I then became aware that he had those two movies under his belt.
Right.
But again, I hadn't seen anything of either of them, and I pitched the movie to him then and said, look, you know, the movie's yours if you will do it. Huh. And he committed to the movie then without having read a script, actually, because we didn't read a script at that point.
So if you wanted Abby Cornish from Somersault also, you would have had to hire Charlize Theron instead of Helen to play the older version.
Right.
That's how that works around here. His story is kind of amazing. I mean, the way Jim Cameron tells it, he was kind of living out of his car shortly before he started getting all these movie roles.
Yeah. He definitely put in his time in kind of independent cinema in Australia. You know, he was a carpenter or a bricklayer or a laborer, certainly, is what he told me. For a long time, he had a girlfriend who was an actress, and she auditioned for a drama school, and somehow persuaded him to do the same, and he got in, and she didn't. Hmm. So he's done his training, Sam. You know, he's had a classical training as well, and I mean, I know he's done Shakespeare and a bunch of other stuff. He's very diligent. You know, really does his homework. He reads a lot, thinks a lot, and you know. The side that you see in The Debt is not the side that people who've seen Clash of the Titans or Terminator will have seen. Or you can see a little bit of in the non-Avatar part of his character in Avatar. But I think he has a very particular range in a sort of shy emotionality and a kind of hidden sort of quality in his acting, which is very compelling. I mean, he's obviously incredibly charismatic on screen. It just felt like such a good fit for this character.
Well, when you see him,
and a good match for Martin too.
Yeah, when you see him at the beginning of this, you're not sure because you've seen him in these other things, and okay, and it turns out to be probably his most intricate, certainly American, performance.
Yes.
And he does it. I mean, there's no question for a second once he starts going.
No, absolutely. No, he completely pulls it off. Yeah.
And so, was it intimidating for her to come into the middle of all this?
For Jessica? I don't think so, no. I mean, she's a very quietly assured presence. I mean, she's really instinctive and intelligent and emotionally focused. She's emotionally very intelligent anyway as an actress, so she instinctively knows what choice she needs to take.
She spent a lot of time on just her face.
I do.
Without even, you know, words a lot of the time.
No, absolutely. Well, we stripped as many of the words away as we could, but she has that gift that Helen has, that she's emotionally transparent. You can literally read what's happening to her. I always wanted this very fragile creature who's obviously co-opted to the mission for a particular reason when they realize they need a woman, and she's transferred from another department, has no field experience at all.
Right.
You know, this fragile creature sort of sandwiched between two very powerful men, or physically powerful men. But the dynamic was really good between them. I mean, mm-hmm. they had to, you know, rehearsal. I had to get all the combat techniques down and learn the piano and various other things.
And Helen, I guess, was the only adult that had to learn that. Or did she have to learn stuff?
Well, no, she didn't. No, her Krav Maga skills were well in abeyance by the time that she has to deploy them.
Yeah.
No, she was the only one who had any contact with the younger three, because I put her and Jessica together pretty early on so that Jessica could start channeling Helen. No, it was a very fruitful rehearsal period for them. They, because we shot the core of the movie, the sequence in the safe house, right at the beginning, which is the first 3 weeks is all we did.
So and the German, in the middle of it, I don't recall ever seeing before, but he's incredible.
Another tremendously well kept secret. Hopefully not any longer. again, that part was a part I always wanted to resist a kind of star casting for. Although on paper it looks like a star role, of course, because it's a it's a monster. It's a big. Monster, and that's a very interesting thing to play. But I thought it, for the authenticity of the piece, you needed somebody who, again, was under the radar, that the audience would immediately have a set of associations with, or was not watching the impersonation of something, which I think tends to encourage a kind of two-dimensionality, and that it's very difficult to approach a character like that and figure out how you could make him three-dimensional. Jesper Christensen, who plays the part, rather astonishingly, is Danish, and is a titanic figure, I think, in German, Danish stage and in film. He's a very, very well-known actor and very highly regarded actor, who's only just beginning to be known outside, in the international arena. He actually is in the James Bond film, the last two James Bond films. I think he plays Mr. White. He appears at the beginning of the last James Bond film with his trouser leg inexplicably rolled up and being beaten about the head. He's a fantastic actor. He came in and read for me on the day of the James Bond film opened in London and sat on the floor and did his stuff with me. And he was astonishing, I thought.
He really is like... It's an interesting balance, and he really hits it.
Yeah, he does. Exactly. Particularly because I think... You come at the character via his public persona rather than the persona he might be perceived to be by the people who are pursuing him in the story, and he's utterly persuasive and charming and avuncular as a doctor.
Yeah, you can see him trying to figure it out as he goes.
And yes,
he takes you on that journey, which is critical for the audience and something like this.
I mean, he's a proper actor. He's a really fantastic actor.
So are you running out of dames to make movies with?
Who's left? I'll have to make a few more.
Is there Judy Parfitt? Or I don't know who's left, who's been damed. So is Helen just a force of nature, or do you actually have to direct her very hard?
Well, she's really unusual as an actress. She's always been fearless is the word I would use about her and do use about her. She's quite uninhibited as a performer, and has this thing where she's, rather counter to what you might expect as she's got older. She's got more and more and more relaxed about everything, and I think post the Queen doesn't have really anything to prove to anybody and never has on stage, but in the movies that essentially transformed everybody's perception of her, and woke them up. Perhaps in the same way that, nothing to do with me, but that Mrs. Brown did for Judy, who was not known as a film actress at all before that moment. Helen obviously was, but she is...
I seem to remember like 5 years ago at the Golden Globes or something, I think she was nominated for the TV series.
Elizabeth.
For
Prime Suspect.
Prime Suspect.
Yes.
And it was kind of like, I'm like, Helen Mirren. And people were kind of like passing her and not notice. I mean, everybody knew who she was, but it wasn't like, and now they go absolutely
nuts.
She's
an iconic figure, of course.
The scene last night at the premiere was just, they were going crazy for her.
They absolutely were, yeah. And and she generates more yelling and screaming and swooning in the autograph hounds than Sam does, actually.
Yeah, something.
But no, she is also unusual as an actress because she actually actively loves to put herself in the hands of a director. That's mm-hmm. really what motivates her, I think. She wants to be challenged by work. You know, she sort of embraces Julie Taymor's supposition that she should play a female version of Prospero.
Mm-hmm.
Another movie she did that's in the festival here, Brighton Rock, a remake of Brighton Rock.
Right.
She did because she saw Rowan Joffe's movie shooting of Thomas Herndl, which is an excellent piece, and thought, okay, this guy's got it. I want to work with him. And so she's very unusual in that respect. She's totally unself-protective and just wants to put herself primarily at the service of the story. And if she connects with the material, then you're off and running. And if she doesn't, then she doesn't do it, obviously. But no, she's fantastic to work with.
It's hard to imagine somehow you with a whip handle.
You don't need pushing a whip them handle along. With her. I mean, she's also very, very generous to the other actors. She's got obviously a lot of experience to bestow. But you know, she was actually standing alongside me trying to explain to an actor what I was trying to explain to them. Saying, I think what he wants you to do is this, you know.
Sub-directing.
Yes. Perfectly happy.
And Wilkinson is a joy to behold, as always.
I remember when we met before,
yes.
He had just been nominated for In the Bedroom. You were telling me about that film, which I hadn't seen at that point. It was suddenly a surprise horse in the Oscar
race.
Yeah,
he was amazing.
Yeah, he's incredible. He's doing... It's the third film I've done with him, and he's in the next film I'm making as well.
So what are you making?
making a comedy set in India about outsourcing retirement to the subcontinent. Very, very funny, poignant script about a group of unconnected English people of retirement age who take up an opportunity to retire in a what is billed as a sort of refurbished Indian palace, which is somewhat short of the reality. And all of these people, for completely different reasons, take up this opportunity with, you know, interesting and unexpected results. But fantastic cast. A few dames, I have to admit.
You always got to get in a dame or two.
Yeah.
So are you, is that something that already has distribution for the United States?
Yes,
or something?
It's Searchlight. Searchlight are financing it.
So that's fun too.
Yes.
Another group to be playing with.
Yeah, absolutely.
So do you feel like you haven't really gone anywhere, but it's been a kind of a little lull in the amount of product that's come out. And now, you know, you come to Toronto, and this is kind of one of the, oddly, one of the surprise films of the festival, I guess, because Miramax has been in play. And
yes.
And it turns out Disney supported the movie enormously.
Yes.
But do you feel like this is time for the next wave of John Madden?
I think these things do go in waves, you know, and for various reasons, projects kind of appear to come to life and then stall, and funding changes or whatever it may be. And then suddenly a lot of buses come along at once.
Right.
But no, it's actually particularly pleasurable to get a film. You know, to make a film like The Debt, which is one kind of challenge, which I, you know, relished and devoured. And then suddenly to be able to go back to a comedy, which I haven't directed a comedy since Shakespeare, which is a pleasure of a completely different kind, again, which I'm really happy to do. I think it's good. It's an interesting time. And, it's quite liberating, though I had amazing time at Miramax, and I think owe my career in large measure to Harvey Weinstein's faith in me. At the same time, it's good to be able to spread my wings a little bit.
Is it still fun to get behind the camera as
Completely.
Much as it was? Or has it gotten better, or is it the same?
No, it's just got more difficult to make films. You know, they now expect you to do more for less, and perhaps 'twas ever thus. I don't know if it was always thus. It's really hard to... You're just calling on the reserves of people's energy and commitment all the time just to get on terms with what you've got to do in the time and money that are available now. But I can't bleat about it. If I've got a studio behind me, that's a situation which makes me, approximately 100 times luckier than most people out there trying to make movies. So But you know, Toronto this year, I mean, is I would say is spelling very promising things for the independent market. There's a whole bunch of very, very strong films out there, you know, that I think is going to make people sit up and go, wait a minute, maybe the independent market is worth investing in again.
Yeah.
From a studio perspective.
Well, it's funny because we were talking to Stephen Frears the other day about his film,
yeah.
And he was very excited that he was perhaps the oldest working director in the world. But you're getting, you know, you're
not far behind.
You're 10 years
not
behind, maybe
behind.
10, 15
I'll
years
be
behind.
I'll be looking for retirement opportunities in India shortly, I expect.
But it's kind of thrilling that, because America, there's like a real age, there's a glass ceiling for age, where they kind of somehow think when you hit 60 or 65 that it's over, and that they don't ever want to hear from you again.
I know.
It's like these great directors who just can't get work, who can't, you know, who don't have the opportunity.
I know. I think we have a sort of a slight inside track being in the UK. I don't know why that should be, but I think it's tougher if you're here.
There seems to be more respect for actually being good.
God forbid.
It's a priority.
Yeah.
So was sitting in that room last night a gratifying
it was
moment?
Pretty gratifying, yeah. I mean, because obviously I haven't had the experience of seeing the film play to a large house like that, or even really any house.
Yeah.
Though we played in Deauville last week, where we had a similar response. Yeah, it was a very, very, particularly for a film that, you know, by the end of it is your solar plexus feels a little massaged. To get that kind of instant response was great, fantastic.
Yeah, and is that that's I guess the festival the festival joy is.
It is. When you're, as I said before, you're dealing to a non-judgmental. Well, certainly my experience here is Cannes may not be quite the same, where they're ready to cheer or boo, but not much in between.
Yeah. It's not unlike
here,
that here. They're kind of,
maybe.
There's not a lot
maybe
of gray.
I just got lucky, I don't know, but I'm certainly...
You've been good.
certainly I felt, yeah, fantastic support for the film.